हेलो स्टूडेंट्स, आई एम सुमन दुआ फ्रॉम डिपार्टमेंट ऑफ एंथ्रोपोलॉजी, यूनिवर्सिटी ऑफ दिल्ली दिल्ली. टुडे आई एम गोइंग टू स्पीक ऑन द मॉड्यूल नेचर एंड कल्चर फिनोमिनोलॉजिकल अप्रोच फ्रॉम द पेपर इकोलॉजिकल एंथ्रोपोलॉजी. द मीनिंग द लर्निंग ऑब्जेक्टिव्स ऑफ द मॉड्यूल आर आफ्टर स्टडिंग दिस मॉड्यूल द वी विल अंडरस्टैंड द डिस्कोर्स ऑफ कॉम्प्लेक्सिटी ऑफ interconnections that exist between nature and culture from theoretical underpinning, the role of ecological anthropology to comprehend nature and culture dualism, the concept of nature and culture through phenomenology, the eco-phenomenological approach to understand the relationship between human culture and the natural environment, the distinction between nature and culture is one of a succession of classic logocentric oppositions described in Western scholars' writings. They believed that anything which is the result of human intervention cannot belong to nature, and in the same way, human achieved cultural development by opposing nature. Boas elucidated that cultural differentiations are not the products of differences in outer environment. Rather, he defined it by inner biology and, of course, some commendable forces within culture itself. Perhaps his student Benedict opposed Boas for his strict biological viewpoint and pointed out the institutions that human cultures build up upon the hints presented by the environment or by man's physical necessities do not keep as close to the original impulse as we easily imagine. These hints are, in reality, mere rough sketches, a list of bare facts. They are pinpoint potentialities, and the elaboration that takes place around them is dictated by many alien considerations. Benedict also argued that many cultures are at the complete opposite ends of the spectrum when it comes to specific areas of culture and lifestyle. But like Boas, she believed that culture was the product of human choices rather than cultural determinism. Indeed, in this context, French anthropologist Lévi-Strauss's argument is most influential. He argued that nature and culture distinction is present all over the world across societies in the form of cognitive tool to understand the world. He also opined that universality of distinction between nature and culture clearly manifests the opposition between human, the controller of nature, and animal, natural. Some of his followers even suggested that the binary opposition between man and women could fall in this dichotomy, as women gives birth, which is a natural endowment, and on the other hand, man, who controls political or ritual processes, is a cultural entitlement. Structuralists believe that what is natural, not determined by any norms, is universal, and what is specified and regulated by norm of a society is culture, and thus culture vary from society to society. A nature-culture distinction became blurred after the passing of post-structuralist concept that structure is always unstable. If incest is universal, it means it is natural and present in all society. But Derrida discussed in the book Writing and Difference that incest is also specific for cultures, as every culture has a tendency to work beyond laws in its own way. He also stated, I quote, "It could perhaps be said that the whole of philosophical conceptualization systematically relating itself to the nature culture opposition is designed to live in the domain of the unthinkable, the very thing that makes this conceptualization possible. The origin of the prohibition of incest, I unquote. He questioned how something can fit on both the sides of nature and culture, considering structuralist viewpoint. Derrida believed the totality of a text as a unit of study is nothing but a fallacy of structuralism. Structuralists define stable system in the form of language and delimited the structure of knowledge. In this sense, the difference between nature and culture is actually creating an effect of decidable meaning, is indeed a structuralist like Lévi-Strauss and others. Fallacy, what Derrida called scandal. As Derrida portrayed that binary opposition are basically hierarchies. The nature and culture opposition not simply define the differences of two poles, rather privileging one at the price of the others. For example, humans are superior to animals. Derrida's concept explained that meaning is deferred from one interpretation to another in an endless way. So it is fact that knowledge constantly deconstructs itself. Role of ecological anthropology to understand the interaction between nature and culture. The term ecological anthropology emerged during the 1960s. This was due to the contributions of many cultural ecologists, including Daryl Forde, Alfred Kroeber, and especially Julian Stewart. Stewart's cultural ecology, influenced by many ecological anthropologists like Roy, Rappaport, Andrew P. Vaida, and others, but the analytic element shifted from culture to the ecological population, which was seen as using culture as a means, that is the primary means of adaptation to environments. Until 1960, the concept that environment is responsible for shaping culture, that is environmental determinism, was the dominant approach in ecological anthropology. But frequently a question comes up that whether cultures adapt to their environment in the same way that the organisms do. Researchers started to believe that the process of adaptation could explain the customs and institutions. Perhaps after 1960s, ecological anthropologists became more structural in the view. According to Bessac, cultures and ecosystems are not directly commensurable. An ecosystem is a system of matter and energy transactions among unlike populations or organisms and between them and the non-living substances by which they are surrounded. Culture is the label for the category of phenomena distinguished from others by its contingency upon symbols. Scholars very often relate cultural materialism with ecological anthropology and showed the adaptive functions of cultural phenomena. Rappaport focused on rituals in the ecology of New Guinea people, and at the same time Harris analyzed the adaptive conservatory role of Hindu doctrine of Ahimsa, with special reference to the cultural ecology of India's sacred cattle. Murphy emphasized that human beings should be studied apart from nature and opposite to it. But he also admitted this does not mean that the human sphere and the natural orders are unrelated, but only implies that the social order is independent despite its ties with the environment. He explained culture in naturalistic term, specifically with respect to its adaptive functions. Therefore, according to Murphy, the characteristics of a culture are not easily reducible to survival values. Howell, in his essay Nature in Culture or Culture in Nature, portrayed Chuong, a small group of Aboriginal people of the Malay tropical rainforest who defined themselves as jungle people and as digging people. as they dig for wild tubers. That is, they are foragers rather than cultivators. Howell showed how individuals are focused upon and derive their identity from the jungle. Howell argued that the jungle in its totality, like material and spiritual world, is cultural space, not natural. They move around in it with confidence, derived from understanding and knowledge. It is full of signs which they know how to interpret, historically, practically, cosmologically. These may be paths made by animals, a fruit tree planted by an ancestor, stones which are inhabited by potentially harmful beings, fallen tree trunks, the place where an event in a particular myth took place, etc. Thus, to Howell, nothing in the forest is semantically neutral. The tree fell because someone, somewhere, laughed near an animal. Rain during sunshine indicates the presence of spirits who are hunting for meat, which would include the human revive. Were they to encounter it and so on? Like other hunting and gathering people, the Chuang displayed a detailed and intimate knowledge of the forest in which they live, which goes far beyond any practical requirement, and they are engaged in a series of meaningful relationships with it. However, the principles of the symbiosis can only be understood by stepping back and placing it within their cosmological constructions. Then comes the experience of nature and culture, a phenomenological approach. In seeking a new approach to see, think, understand, and construct the world, phenomenology tries to understand first what has happened and what has been assumed in what context. This approach studies the structures of consciousness as experienced from the first person point of view, meaning how things appear to our conscious awareness or how the world appears to people in terms of their subjective experience. Phenomenology allows phenomena to be understood as they are without the deduction or distortion, so often the result or positive science or the many styles of structuralism. Phenomenology as a style of reflection and a practice of life invites us to drop beneath our accepted abstractions in order to pay close attention to our directly felt experience of things. It asks us to notice the way that the surrounding world and its manifold constituents spontaneously disclose themselves to our most immediate awareness. Phenomenology invites us to trade in our concepts for fresh percepts, to trade theoretical schemata for difficult articulation of our ongoing experience of the real in its inexhaustible strangeness. New phase of phenomenology and hermeneutics of embodied persons and world considers the complexity indicated core of how we live. Mugger speaks of environmental hermeneutics, that is, a way of interpretation which evokes what things are and how they are related to other things in the webs of particular lives and places. Phenomenology is also concerned about the relationship between human behavior and environment, and the most clearly emphasized areas to such research are geography, environmental psychology, and architecture. A phenomenology of environment and space examines three major themes. First, the essential qualities and interconnections of human environmental experience. Second, essential qualities of environment such as sound, topography, light, spatial qualities which promote a particular character of space and landscape. Third, the larger context of societal and symbolic environments fundamental to space. Nothengel wrote the concept space of negotiation, issuing from the French approach to the anthropology of sciences, is especially valuable in the perspective of nature and culture. Distinction because it precludes any pre-established distinction between contents and context by including all the various items negotiated and translated, as well as various sectors negotiating and translating into a common field. Thus, a space of negotiation is based on mediating processes and intermediaries passing between the actors and defining their relationship. These mediating links include technical artifacts, literal inscriptions, human beings, and money. The nature-culture interface is given in the image by Nothengel, 1996. Nothengel noted, "We know from cultural anthropology, hunting is one of the mediating activities between nature and culture, characterized by a very pronounced symbolical value. It entails not only a transformation of nature into culture, converting a wild animal into an edible prey, but also a whole set of socio-cultural values. These values include mechanisms of sharing and distribution, as well as mechanisms of power differentiation, gender separation, for instance. Since hunting is usually deemed more prestigious than crop cultivation, this marked symbolic value also reveals itself in a historical perspective, insofar as many cultural heroes are characterized as hunters. In general terms, one can say that wild nature serves as a reservoir of socio-cultural meaning. Thus, meaning and sense, power and domination are extracted out of these transformational mediating activities. So, it can be inferred that nature is often constructed as the other, an outside entity. At the same time, nature is intimately linked to culture, being characterized by particular organizational structure and distinctive kind of habitus. Then comes eco-phenomenology to understand nature and culture. Woods defined eco-phenomenology, in which both an ecological phenomenology and a phenomenological ecology are folded. That offers us a way of developing a middle ground between phenomenology and naturalism, between intentionality and casuality. Eco-phenomenology is based on a double claim. Firstly, that an adequate account of our ecological situation requires the methods and insights of phenomenology, and secondly, the phenomenology led by its own momentum becomes a philosophical ecology, that is, a study of the relationship between organism and the world in its metaphysical and axiological dimensions. Eco-phenomenology focuses on the cultural and symbolic dimensions of environment and place. For example, essays by Walter Brennan and David Sale give attention to the spiritual qualities of environment and place. Brennan examined Ireland's holy springs, more commonly called wells. He argued that these wells consolidate two different forces, the sacred and Doric. Brennan pointed that the former is a centrifugal force and underlies all universal religious patterns and structures. For example, myths and rituals are repeated in the same way and times throughout a sacred world, as for instance, the Catholic Mass. In contrast, Doric power is centripetal, drawing towards the center. In terms of sense of sacred place, Brennan argued, the Doric power is crucial because it endows a particular site and uniqueness, as with the Irish holy wells. Only much later, once Catholicism had gained power in Ireland, the wells became a symbol of the sacred. For a phenomenology of place, Brennan's most intriguing point is that Doric power generates a sense of intimacy. yet that intimacy is completely hidden to those who possess it. Shelley's essay on Pueblo dwelling in the southwestern United States echoes several of Brenneman's themes effectively, demonstrating the juncture of sacred and lowered powers at a community and regional scale, focusing on insiders and outsiders' sense of Pueblo dwelling and place. Shelley describes the elaborate way in which environmental elements such as mountains, lakes, caves, springs, shrines, village layout and buildings fit together to provide a landscape fostering and reflecting a profound sacred meaning. He further suggested that each particular place and site possesses its own lyric quality, yet underlying the uniqueness are sacred themes, patterns more or less common. Through this discussion of outsiders' views of Pueblo word, Shelley also demonstrated how readily descriptions of what word can be distorted. In the essay, The Dwelling Door, Towards the Phenomenology of Transition, Richard Lang considers dwelling as an embodied inhabit. Lang considers the home as an extension of bodily existence. He looks at one aspect of the home, the door, as a phrasing for access and disclosure. He argued that door concretizes and reflects the experience of transition, animating in a visible manner the dialectic of inside and outside. In a similar way, Jagger examines the relationship among body, house, and city. Like Lang, Jagger emphasizes the significance of physical embodiment, particularly through architectural expression, in establishing a sense of familiarity and dwelling. Both body and built environment, says Jagger, are visible and at the same time they foster vision. In this portrayal, Jagger points to a useful new way of phrasing the intimate relationship and immersion between person and the world. The physical world is what one sees, but it is also the foundation and context of that seeing. The embodied world, therefore, has a primary role in sustaining particular modes of human being and becoming. The designer has the responsibility to create a built environment which projects and supports a civilized seeing and a humane inhabitation. Let us summarize the module. In the phenomenologist quest, specific environmental elements or experiences are the basis for wider generalizations about behavior, landscape, meaning, and so forth. The search is for underlying structures, networks of relationships, marking out essential dimensions of the thing, event, or experience. These structures incorporate a series of infrastructural connections and tensions which in their various combinations generate particular modes and contexts of meanings, behaviors and experiences. A central aspect of phenomenology is the identification and description of folds, that is, complexes of pattern and meaning which outline the underlying continuing order of things, processes and experiences. Bott argues that a science of authentic wholeness would not only promote a clearer seeing of phenomena, but also generate a deeper compassion and reverence for a nature and the environment. Thank you.